God only made occasional appearances to his people. When they were in trouble, when they cried out to him, he would appear. But most of the time, he wasn't actively visible among them. All the surrounding nations, their gods were not visible among them either. Their gods, in inverted commas, because of course they weren't real gods. Their gods, they believed, lived on remote mountains somewhere and occasionally would listen to offerings and prayers and help the people out. But here is a major, major difference. This, and you sort of take this for granted today. But this is a huge difference. God now is coming to reside, to live, to tabernacle, to be in the abode in the middle of the camp. And we take God's presence with us for granted, don't we? I mean, we have the Holy Spirit inside us. We meet here this morning. You know, God's been active among us. And we just take all of that for granted, don't we? Can you imagine that God had never, ever been with us? And one day God says, I'm going to come and live in the middle of you, in your midst. Can you imagine what a fantastic change that would be? Isn't that awesome? And that's what's happening here.
This is GBC Web TV. On the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called God Among Us, Exodus chapter 25 verse 1 through to 26 verse 37 by Pastor David Wise.
Father God, we thank you for your presence with us this morning. Thank you for the worship, for the prayer, for the ministry. Thank you that you've been here and you're among us. And thank you that you're still here now. In fact, you are God among us. And as Father, as we come and look at this next passage from Exodus this morning, look at your word, we ask that you will speak to us. Father, as we often pray, we don't simply want to gather information, we want revelation from yourself into our lives and situations. In Jesus' name, amen. On Sunday mornings, when I'm here for most of the time, we have been looking at the book of Exodus. And if you're here for the first time, just to say to you that the book of Exodus and the events that are narrated in it is probably the most significant part of the Old Testament. It's foundational to everything else that follows in the Old Testament. And in many ways, it's the Old Testament equivalent of the Gospels. And if you've missed any of the sections, they're all on our website. And I was chatting to someone last week or during the week who, for the first time, had been on the website, had looked at some of the Exodus teaching that was there before they started coming to the church. And they said, the quality is so good, Pastor, they said. It is wonderful. It's like you're there in person. Now, I don't know whether that means they're going to stop coming on Sundays and just watch me on the... I just encourage you to, if you want to pick up any of the previous sections, it's all there on our website. Last week, we looked at the people confirming their covenant with God. Were you here last week? If you were here last week, put your hand up. I'm sure there were more than about 10 people here last week. I'm just checking. Excellent. Okay. What were the main lessons? We looked at that. Confirming of the covenant last week, and in some ways it was quite a deep passage, and we dug about in some quite deep things last week as we looked at that. What are the principles we took away from that passage last week that we took away into our lives coming out of that are going to lead us into what we're going to look at this morning? So principles from last week, what were the key lessons we took away? Leslie?
To make God a part of all of our lives, every aspect of it.
Every aspect of our lives. In fact, all of life should be grounded in worship. Do you remember we saw the whole of that last week was all about worship, and that worship is about the way we live our lives. Very good. Mary?
You talked about it was a very, very close relationship, like when they had blood brothers, and that they were part of each other.
Yes, we talked about that, the whole thing. We had all this blood last time, and the blood on the people, Remember, the blood was sprinkled over the people and the blood was poured over the altar, which stood for God's presence in the middle. And how that relationship, they were of one blood together. And it was like in some cultures, that blood-brother relationship between God and his people. I remember some of you grimacing last week when I talked about all this blood being sprinkled over the people. You weren't up for that. I remember some. Other principles that we saw last time. There's one really important one that takes us into today, so let's hope we can find the link here. Yes? That is absolutely what I'm looking for. God is always journeying with us. God is always with us. And it's that that links into the passage we're going to look at today. Now, for some of you, when you've been one of the programs we've pushed here over the years, is reading the Bible through in a year. And I often say to people, if they've been Christians for a while and they've not read the Bible all the way through, it's something they ought to do. And you should use a reading program. You can do it just in 10, 15 minutes a day. Over a whole year, you can read the whole of the Bible. But there are some parts of the Bible you read and you think, oh, this is fantastic. This is obviously relevant to my life. And there are other bits you read, you think, what is this about? Now, in the Old Testament, there are, wait for it, 13 chapters, 13 entire chapters given over to the construction of the tabernacle, including detailed descriptions of the furniture on the inside, the decoration of the tent, the materials that it was made from, and all of that there. And you look at that and you read it, and I don't know about you, sometimes your mind goes a bit numb. You think, what is this about? 13 chapters of this. They're not all in Exodus, you'll be pleased to know. They're elsewhere as well. And I want to take a few moments. We're going to look today at the whole of chapter 25 and the whole of chapter 26. So we're covering, it's over 70 verses we are looking at this morning. But I want to spend a few minutes looking at how we deal with this sort of scripture. Because I want to try and teach some principles here about how we understand scripture. And when we come to these passages to do with the tabernacle, there are four main approaches that Christians take when they come to look at these passages. And I want to just very briefly outline the four of them and to express some reservations about some of them as well. So you see where I'm coming from as in the way that we approach scripture here. So all right if I do that? I'm going to do it anyway, but, you know, it's nice to have a bit of nodding, a bit of encouragement. So this is called, if you want a really fancy word, you want to really impress people, this week, say, in church on Sunday, we learnt some biblical hermeneutics. Okay? Biblical hermeneutics. So if you really want to impress someone, we said we did biblical hermeneutics in church on Sunday. And they'll think, wow, that's amazing. What does it mean, they'll say to you? So, four main approaches to this section that we're going to begin looking at today. And one of those approaches you could call symbol or allegory. And what it's about, people that take this approach, we recognize the Bible is full of symbols, and the Old and New Testament. But this approach looks for hidden meanings. Things that aren't obvious when you look at the text. They aren't obvious symbols. So they're looking at the hidden meanings of Scripture. And there are loads of it about the tabernacle. I mean, there are whole books written about it. And I've read some of it. The problem with it is this, in my opinion, that all you're actually reading is what's going on in the person's mind. Because this is about what I try and do when we look at Scripture. What we do together is what's known... if you want a nice fancy word, big words this morning, exegesis. We're looking at Scripture and we're getting the meaning out of Scripture, ex out of Scripture, out of exegesis, looking at God's Word and extracting the meaning for us. The opposite of that, theologians call, another nice big word, eisegesis. And that's when we put my stuff into Scripture and we read it as though it's a reflection of me. And so when we start doing that with these symbols, we take what writers tend to do is take their own hobby horses, their own personal interests, and they're looking at the colours of the... I read one this week. Looking at the colours of the threads that were used to make the part of the inner tent of the Holy of Holies. and explaining the significance of each of these colours and how it applied to our Christian lives today. Now, the trouble is, you read some other writer and they look at the same colours and it all completely different meanings, and it's all about their own hobby horses. So I really don't think this thing of going down hidden meanings, symbol, yes, we're going to look at some symbols today, but not getting into this hidden meanings, I really don't think that is helpful for us. The second approach that I really don't think cuts the mustard is treating it simply as historical or architectural text. So the only interest in it is about history or about architecture. I mean, history is interesting, isn't it? Architecture is interesting, but actually that isn't about your life today. And the Bible's very clear. Let's just keep your fingers in Exodus if you want to, and just turn to this verse in the New Testament, 2 Timothy. You can listen to it just if you want to. It's just one verse, 2 Timothy 3 and verse 16. It says this. You ready? All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. How much of Scripture?
All.
Does that include 13 chapters on the tabernacle?
Yes.
Okay, but it's given, it's God-breathed, and it's given, useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness, so that the man or woman of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. And I don't think just looking at how the poles hang together in the tabernacle equips you as a man or woman of God. So if we reduce it just to that, I think we are falling short of what this passage is about. A third idea, and this actually is very complicated, and I'm not going to explain this hugely well. If you want me to spend 15 minutes explaining to you on another occasion, this is the idea of the development of ideas or historical tradition. And the idea is they take this passage of, and again, I was reading another commentator this week that did this, takes these chapters and says, well, actually, these weren't all written at the time. So what we've got here is different people at different points in history writing back what was significant for them that they would like to have seen in the tabernacle that probably never existed in the first place. And Warren, in his degree in theology, will be spending some time looking at some of these theories. That's going to be exciting for you in the next couple of years. And they divide the whole of Exodus up into these different segments that allegedly come from different periods in history, putting most of it actually post-exile, so being written a long, long time later. And I don't think that takes it seriously, that as far as I'm concerned, this is God's word. And we take it as God's word, and God speaks to us. So I really don't think that really does it seriously either. The fourth is called the textual or literary approach. And one of the things that it does, it takes the tabernacle passage and it looks at it alongside other similar passages or passages with similar themes, particularly in the Old Testament. Now, in a few weeks' time, we're going to do that with the construction of the tabernacle and the making of the golden calf. If you're not familiar with that story, we're going to get to it in a few weeks' time. Because there are some clear points that that God is making through the writers, they're making to us about how we worship God. You know, that it's God's design, not human design, and all the way through. So that's one good passage. Another good, if you've got really long memories, if you've been at church here coming for a while, and you've got a long memory, you'll remember a series that I did looking at the beginning of Genesis. We've actually previously done the whole of the book of Genesis in three or four goes, but we did a series looking at the beginning of Genesis. Anybody remember that? Is it vaguely in people's minds? Oh, a few people, yeah. It was probably 6 or 7 years ago. And one of the fascinating things about the Garden of Eden is that it's laid out exactly the same as the tabernacle. I'll draw one of the parallels later on. But when you look at the Garden of Eden and you look at the tabernacle, they're laid out exactly the same. In fact, some of the same furniture inside them. What does that tell us? Well, it actually tells us something. It's the main thing that we're going to with this morning. It tells us something about God and God wanting to be among his people, which is the subject for this morning, God among his people. The detail of that is for another time. So that's the sort of approach that we're leading. I'm taking this as God's word, and I'm looking to see, what does this say to us today about God? So that's where we're going this morning. So let's begin. We're going to move through this text fairly rapidly, particularly chapter 26, which we're going to go through at a fair pace. So we're going to begin chapter 25, and we're beginning at verse 1. The Lord said to Moses, "Tell the Israelites you are to bring me an offering. You are to receive the offering for me from each man whose heart prompts him to give. These are the offerings you are to receive from them: gold, silver, bronze, blue, purple and scarlet yarn, fine linen, goat hair, ram skins, dyed red, hides of sea cows." Sea cows is a bit of a guess, actually. They're not quite sure what the Hebrew word there means. They know it's some form of fine leather, but you'll find different translations of the Bible use a different word there, because it's basically because the Hebrew word there, they're not quite sure. It's an ancient word. They're not quite sure which leather it means, but it's something of that sort. Acacia wood, olive oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil and for the fragrant incense, oink stones and other gems to be mounted on the ephod and the breastpiece. Whole list of stuff. Now, do you remember? Well, first of all, let's say this was a free will offering. This wasn't a tax. This wasn't God saying, "Okay, everybody, you've got to give me some of your stuff." This was a free will offering. But do you remember that when the people left Egypt, they took a large amount of gold and silver and other valuable plunder from the Egyptians? Do you remember that? They were told to ask of, that God told them to ask of their previous captors gold, silver and all sorts of other stuff. And you might have thought, what on earth are they going to want that for when they're walking around the desert? It's not a lot of use in the desert, not a lot of trading in the desert with gold, silver, bronze, and all sorts of other precious stones and linens and all of that sort of stuff. Why are they carting this all around? Well, God knew that they were going to need it later on. So he's equipping the people right the way back then with stuff they didn't know they were going to need. They're just carting it around the wilderness. And God says, okay, now's the time, if it's in your heart to make a free will offering of those things to me. And you know, it's an amazing thing. I came across this quote this week. It was written in 1890. I like this. "The humblest man whose heart is willing may contribute towards an abode or a house for him who the heaven of heavens cannot contain. Isn't that amazing? The humblest person who God had set free from Egypt are now able to contribute into an abode, a resting place, for he who the heaven of heavens cannot contain. Oh. Anyway, verse 8. "Then have them make a sanctuary for me, and I will dwell among them. Make this tabernacle and all its furnishings exactly like the pattern I will show you." This is crucial. This is what all of this is about. This verse 8 is the absolute key verse in understanding what here is a major change in the relationship of God to his people Israel. It's a huge change. Prior to this point, God only made occasional appearances to his people. When they were in trouble, when they cried out to him, he would appear. But most of the time, he wasn't actively visible among them. All the surrounding nations, their gods were not visible among them either. Their gods, in inverted commas, because of course they weren't real gods. Their gods, they believed, lived on remote mountains somewhere and occasionally would listen to offerings and prayers and help the people out. But here is a major, major difference. This, and you sort of take this for granted today. But this is a huge difference. God now is coming to reside, to live, to tabernacle, to be in the abode in the middle of the camp. And we take God's presence with us for granted, don't we? I mean, we have the Holy Spirit inside us. We meet here this morning. You know, God's been active among us. And we just take all of that for granted, don't we? Can you imagine that God had never, ever been with us? And one day God says, I'm going to come and live in the middle of you, in your midst. Can you imagine what a fantastic change that would be? Isn't that awesome? And that's what's happening here. God is saying, I've redeemed you, you're my people. Now I am going to come and live right in the middle of your camp. And to show that I'm there, because you can't see me, you're going to build a tent. And it's going to symbolize my presence. Well, it's more than going to symbolize my presence, because I'm really, really, really going to be there. You won't be able to see me, you'll just be able to see the tent. But I'm going to be there right in the middle. And as you journey, that's why the comment that Elizabeth made earlier on about God journeying with us is so significant. Because this is where it began. And it continues for us today for reasons that we will come to a little bit later on this morning. In fact, no, we'll do it now. We won't keep it till later. Change my mind. Let me read to you, or you can turn to it, a verse from John's Gospel. Now, what are you looking for? That's John chapter 1. The Old Testament was originally written in Hebrew, but eventually it was translated into Greek. The New Testament was originally written in Greek. Now, I mention that because sometimes some of the Greek words from the Greek translation of the Old Testament make their way into the Greek writing of the New Testament. And that when it happens, it's really significant. And this is one of them. John chapter 1 and verse 14. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Anybody want to guess what that word is? It's tabernacle. It's the same word that is used in the Old Testament to describe the tabernacle. So here it is, chapter 1, verse 14. Jesus became flesh and, literally translated, tabernacled among us. So what we see, this awesome change we see here, Exodus 25 and verse 8, this awesome, incredible change, not just foundational to the Old Testament, but right up to today. Yes? Because Jesus today still dwells among us. Amen? He's present here with us this morning. Amen? He's in our lives. And this is where it started, back in the tabernacle. That's why there's 13 chapters about it, because it's such an amazing event. You know, if God puts 13 chapters of something in the Bible, we want to sit up and take notice. Now, why is that there? Why is it so important? Well, it's not because of the colours of the embroidery of the angels on the inside or how the pegs were made or what metal this bit was made from and all of that. It's because of this awesome change that God now is among his people for the very first time. And today, Jesus tabernacles among us. It's amazing. It's awesome. That's why this is so significant. And we use a phrase like Emmanuel, God with us, don't we? And we just take it for granted. But this is where it comes from. This moment in the history of God's people. Right from then, right up to now. Any thoughts or reflections on that? I'll just pause for a moment before we look at this next section. Any other connections you see? Any thoughts, reflections about that? And what we can learn about God? I'm going to go backwards and forwards. Yes. Fiona.
It's free will. It's like God's given us a choice to whether or not we admit that Christ is who he says he is. And it's free will. And back in the Old Testament, it was a free will offering that built the tabernacle.
Yeah, it was a free will. They had the choice.
They had the choice.
They had the choice.
To believe what Moses was telling them to do or to not. And everybody has a choice to believe in Jesus or not.
We have the same today, yes. God doesn't force his presence. He's here this morning, but you could sit here this morning and you could be an atheist. And could just ignore the fact that God is here. It's down to your response to God. I saw a hand over here somewhere, yes.
Yeah, that, God dwells among us now as believers. But, you know, just as exacting, let's say, you know, build it exactly how, like when he gave instructions for the tabernacle, build it exactly like I say. This is the same now, like you have to come to faith in Jesus as the Son of God and trust in him, not just sort of come.
It's on his terms. Yeah. We can't write our own terms. Remember we saw that last time about the covenant. God writes the terms, so it's on his terms. Absolutely right. You see this, sorry, Joan, yeah. Go on, go for it. No, go for it.
You were.
I was about to, but I will do in a moment. Go for it.
This might be totally wrong, but we are the church built of living stone.
Yes.
And it's as though that's a tabernacle.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well done. So we have this thing here. So in the Garden of Eden, whether you take it as being a literal or whether you take it as being a picture, at this moment I don't mind. The point I want to take from that is God's intention was to walk with his people in the garden. Absolutely open with one another in the garden. Okay, but they blew it. So they end up in slavery. God redeems them from slavery. And there is the tabernacle. Why? Because God wants to walk, be there in the middle of his people. But the people of Israel blew it. So then comes another tabernacle. Jesus comes to tabernacle among us. God's presence coming in again among us, to work among us. And as a part of that, Peter talks about the fact that we are living stones built together into a living temple, a place where God dwells. And guess what? When you look in Revelation and you look towards the end, you look at the picture of where we're going, guess what? God's everywhere and we're with him in his presence. You see, it's all the way through there. You see how this joins up. It's always been God's intention to be among his people. And human beings have always had the choice of opting in or out. And so God's had to find other ways for people to get engaged and to be there with his presence. It's amazing, isn't it? Yeah. Oh, I get so excited. I don't necessarily maintain it for all 13 chapters at one sitting, but you get the principle here. All right, let's move on to the next bit. This, by the way, is a very accurate recreation of the Old Testament, what is known, what people talk about, the Ark of the Covenant. The old translations talk about the Ark of the Covenant. The Good News Bible translates it as, I think it calls it the Covenant Box. But the Ark of the Covenant, and this is what it looked like. Let's read about it from verse 10. Have then, make a chest of acacia wood, 2.5 cubits long, that's about a metre, a cubit and a half wide. Why is that about a metre? It's because a cubit actually depended on the carpenter. How long a cubit was depended on the carpenter, because it was to do with how long their arm was. It was a measurement taken from the length of the arm. So if you're like me and got really short arms, some of you will know that I once applied to be a bus driver, and I was turned down because my arms were too short. Can you believe it? So if I was making the Ark of the Covenant, it would be quite small. Some other people here, I'm looking at Wayne here. Wayne, just put your arm up in the air. If Wayne was making it, it would be humongous. So it's about a metre long. So two and a half cubits long and a cubit and a half wide and a cubit and a half high. Overlay it with pure gold, both inside and out, and make a gold moulding around it. Cast four gold rings for it, fasten them to its feet, two rings, fasten them to its 4 feet with two rings on one side, two rings on the other, as you see in the picture. Then make poles of acacia wood, overlay them with gold, and insert the poles into the rings on the sides of the chest to carry it. The poles are to remain in the rings of the ark. They are not to be removed. Then put in the ark the testimony, the two stone tablets, which we're going to come to later on in the story, but not this week, which I will give you. Make an atonement cover of pure gold, 2.5 cubits long and a cubit and a half wide. Make two cherubim out of hammered gold at the ends of the cover. Make one cherub on one end, the second cherub on the other. Make the cherubim of one piece with the cover at the two ends. The cherubim are to have their wings spread upward, overshadowing the cover with them. The cherubim are to face each other, looking towards the cover. Place the cover on top of the ark and put in the ark the testimony which I will give you. There, above the cover, between the two cherubim that are over the ark of the testimony, I will meet with you. God's not in the box. God's not standing on the box. But in that space above the cover, I will meet with you and give you all my commands for the Israelites. So, what it looked like, made of acacia wood, gold-plated, rings at the corners, carrying poles. The poles were there all the time. And the poles, just interestingly, were slightly longer than the space in the tabernacle, in the Holy of Holies, that the ark sat in. So the poles stuck out into the holy place through the curtain. So they knew that it was there because they could see the ends of the poles, but they couldn't see the actual ark itself. One person once a year went in there. We'll come to that in a moment. Inside there's the two stone tablets, and on top was a solid gold cover. Now that atonement cover in the old versions was translated as the mercy seat. So when you hear this phrase about the mercy seat, it's talking about the cover on this box. And it's actually quite important. And it's important for this reason. Because once a year, the high priest went into the holiest, the Holy of Holies, the holiest place of all, where the ark stood. Once a year, one person, the high priest, went in there. And when they went in there with the blood of an animal that had been slain. And they sprinkled the blood on top of the cover. Underneath the cover was God's law, which in the past year the people had broken, because they were like us, they sinned. And so he came in and he put blood on the cover, the mercy seat, the atonement cover. So it was covering over the sins that people had committed over the last year. Of course, it is just a picture pointing forward to Jesus coming and his shed blood. The blood of animals by themselves could never actually give someone forgiveness for sins. It's just a picture of what was coming. And this box, the Ark of the Covenant, was the most important visible sign of God's presence with his people. But it was never worshipped, which is unusual, actually, because most holy boxes end up being worshipped. But this one never was, because it was a symbol that God was present above it. In fact, some talked about it, some of the Psalms talk about it, as the place that God rests his feet. It's his footstool, the Ark of the Covenant, with the mercy seat on the top. Let's look at the other bits of furniture that were in the tabernacle. And then I've got a question to ask you about those. So let's move down to the next one, verse 23. Make a table of acacia wood, 2 cubits long, 1 cubit wide, and 1.5 cubits high. Overlay it with pure gold and make a gold mounding around it. Just the way the metals work, by the way, in the tabernacle is this. If something is close to God, like the cover, it's pure gold. The next close is gold plated. And as you move away, it becomes silver and bronze as you move further away from God's presence. So it had this thing of highlighting the fact that this is where God had chosen that people could meet with him. So overlay it with pure gold, gold moulding around it. Make around it a rim, a hand breadth wide. Put a gold moulding on the rim. 4 gold rings for the table. Fasten them to the 4 corners where the 4 legs are. The 4 rings are to be close to the rim to hold the poles for carrying the table. Make the poles of acacia wood, overlay them with gold. Carry the table with them. Make its plates and dishes of pure gold, as well as its pitchers and bowls for the pouring out of the offerings. And put the bread of the presence on this table to be before me at all times. The bread of the presence. I wonder if that rings any bells with the New Testament. The bread of the presence was 12 flatbreads. And they were put out fresh every day on the table. And then the priests ate them afterwards. Fresh bread the next day. And it was perhaps a reminder, maybe an acknowledgement, that their daily bread came from God. Which, of course, we picked up in the New Testament. Give us each day our daily bread. It goes back to this table and the bread that was there. And remember that at this time, the people were literally receiving their daily bread from God, called manna. I mean, they were literally being supernaturally fed with manna and with quails. So they were literally having their daily bread from God. And of course, we today literally have our daily bread from God in a different sense, because we recognize that everything that we have ultimately comes from God. So we acknowledge that in the prayer that we pray. Give us today our daily bread. So that's the table. Next one, lampstand, verse 31. Make a lampstand of pure gold, hammer it out, base and shaft. Its flower-like cups, buds and blossoms shall be of one piece with it. 6 branches are to extend from the sides of the lampstand, 3 on one side, 3 on the other. 3 cups shaped like almond flowers with buds and blossoms as to be on the one branch, 3 on the next branch, and the same for all 6 branches extending from the lampstand. On the lampstand there are to be 4 cups shaped like almond flowers with buds and blossoms. 1 bud shall be under the first pair of branches extending from the lampstand, 2nd bud under the 2nd pair, 3rd bud under the 3rd pair, 6 branches in all. The buds and branches shall be of one piece with the lampstand hammered out of pure gold. Then make it 7 lamps, set them on it, so they may light the space in front of it. Remember that as you'll see when we come to the Holy of Holies description, there was no daylight at all. It was in total darkness from daylight. The only light was the light from the lampstand. Its wick trimmers, trays are to be of pure gold. A talent of pure gold is to be used for the lampstand and all these accessories. See that you make them according to the pattern shown you on the mountain. The lampstand's also known as the menorah, and it was a symbol of God's care, but it was designed to look like a tree covered in life. Ring any bells? Back in the Garden of Eden, the tree of life. Here again is that same tree, only the other one was literally alive. This one is just made to look alive. So let's just reflect for a few moments. We're going to look at the whole of chapter 26 in a few minutes, but let's reflect first of all on this furniture. We've got the ark, or the covenant box, the table, the lampstand. What can we learn about God from the furniture? That might seem a bit of an odd question. But from these things that are there, what does it tell us? Because we have the same God today, don't we? Amen? So what do we learn? Mary?
What are the fact that it was wood overlaid with gold reflect the humanity of Jesus and the divinity of Jesus?
It's one of those allegorical interpretations that is possible. I mean, we know that Jesus was human and divine. I personally don't think that that's what that was about. But you could look at it and say, well, here is wood, here is gold. Gold speaks of deity. Wood speaks of humanity. So it might remind us of Jesus. But I don't think that was part of the original meaning of the thing there. So what do you learn as we learn from this furniture? Yeah, I wasn't sure whether you were...
With the table, I personally think maybe it symbolizes that God wants us to dine with him all the time.
Mm.
And the lampstand, again, showing that God is the light of the world.
Yeah, there is this whole thing there with a table that is there, with food on the table. And there is this invitation to presence with God. And the fact the priests ate this food, this bread of the presence each day. You know, and of course, we are all today priests, aren't we? In the Old Testament, there were just one group of priests. But now, we are all priests. In the Old Testament, no one could go into that place because there was a curtain that kept people out. On the cross, that was torn in two from top to bottom. So now, we're in the presence. So we are there. So yes, it does speak to us about God's presence, about God's wanting to dine with us. And the whole thing about the only source of light was divine in there. Yes, anything else? Birch.
Verse 22 says, and there I will meet with you, and I'll speak with you. That God is always with us at any point in our life, all the time.
Yes.
It's only we cannot see or hear from him at times.
Very good. He will be there to meet with us. And it is that same principle all the way through. That all that this is about God giving some physical demonstration of his presence there for the people to see. They couldn't see God, but it indicated that he was there. Joan.
It sort of makes me smile to think that this is all very spiritual, and yet God is concerned with the practical details.
Yes, carrying
the architecture.
Poles.
Architecture.
Yeah.
Yeah. And where how the poles should be and how this should be and how that should be.
One of the things that it does tell us, I mean, the description, and we're going to read in one sitting in a moment the whole of the description of how the tabernacle was built. The detail, a lot of it is very detailed. It's not enough detail to be able to build the tabernacle from what is there, because there's important information that isn't there in the text. But the fact there is so much detail, it does tell us about God's concern about every aspect and the little things of life, which we've seen as we've gone through with the laws, yeah? All these little details that have been there. God's concerned about every single aspect of our life. And here, and God is insistent, everything I tell you about this, you do. The way that I tell you to do it. Absolutely insistent about that. Okay, let's read. Well, let me read to you chapter 26. I'm going to do this all in one go, and then I'm going to make just a couple of comments about the chapter. So make the tabernacle or the tent with 10 curtains of finely twisted linen, blue, purple, scarlet yarn, with cherubim worked into them by a skilled craftsman. All the curtains will be the same size, 28 cubits long, 4 cubits wide. Join 5 of the curtains together, do the same with the other 5. Make loops of blue material along the edge of the end curtain in one set, do the same with the end curtain in the other set. 50 hoops on one curtain, 50 hoops on the end curtain of the other set, with the loops opposite each other. Then make 50 gold clasps and use them to fasten the curtains together so that the tabernacle is a unit. So all these bits of curtain all joined together. Make the curtains of goat's hair for the tent over the tabernacle. So that's, if you like, the roof on the outside, covers it over. It's made with the goat's hair, waterproof, 11 there. All 11 curtains are to be the same size, 30 cubits long, 4 cubits wide. Join 5 of the curtains together into one set and the other 6 into another set. Fold the 6th curtain double at the front of the tent. That's so you can get in and out. Make 50 loops along the edge of the end curtain in one set and also along the edge of the end curtain in the other set. Make 50 bronze clasps and put them into loops to fasten the tent together as a unit. As for the additional length of the tent curtains, the half curtain that is left over is to hang down at the rear of the tabernacle. The tent curtains will be a cubit longer on both sides. So this is the outer covering, is extra long, so it comes right down and onto the ground at either side, so as to cover the tabernacle. Make for the tent a covering of ram skins dyed red, and over that a covering of hides of sea cows, or it could be some other fine leather. Make upright frames of acacia wood for the tabernacle. Each frame is to be 10 cubits long, a cubit and a half wide, with two projections set parallel to each other. Make all the frames of the tabernacle in this way. Make 20 frames for the south side of the tabernacle, and 40 silver bases to go under them. Two bases for each frame, one under each projection. For the other side, the north side of the tabernacle, make 20 frames, 40 silver bases, two under each frame. Make six frames for the far end, that is the west end of the tabernacle. Make two frames for the far corners of the far end. At these two corners, they must be double from the bottom all the way to the top, fitted into a single ring. Both shall be like that, so there'll be eight frames and 16 silver bases, two under each frame. Make the crossbars of acacia wood, five for the frames on one side of the tabernacle, five for those on the other side, five for the frames on the west at the far end of the tabernacle. The centre crossbar is to extend from end to end at the middle of the frames. Overlay the frames with gold and make gold rings to hold the crossbars. Overlay the crossbars with gold. Set up the tabernacle according to the plan shown you on the mountain. Make a curtain of blue, purple and scarlet yarn and finely twisted linen, with cherubim worked into it by a skilled craftsman. Hang it with gold hooks on four posts of acacia wood overlaid with gold and standing on four silver bases. Hang the curtains from the clasps and place the Ark of the Testimony behind the curtain. So you've got this dividing curtain that comes down one third of the space behind it, two thirds of the space in front of it. The Ark is behind the curtain. The entrance is at the front. Curtain hangs down. The curtain will separate the holy place from the most holy place. Or older translations would call that the Holy of Holies, the most holy place. Put the atonement cover on the Ark of the Testimony in the most holy place. Place the table outside the curtain on the north side of the tabernacle and put the lampstand opposite on the south side. For the entrance to the tent, make a curtain of blue, purple and scarlet yarn, finely twisted linen, the work of an embroiderer. Make gold hooks for this curtain, five posts of acacia wood overlaid with gold, and cast five bronze bases for them. Well, I'm not going to, you know, go into all the detail of all of that, except to say that this tent, very interestingly, was made just like, in its construction, a standard nomad's tent. I find that very interesting. It's bigger, it's longer, it's wider, it's much more ornate and decorated, though most of the fine decoration would never have been seen. Did you notice the most fine decoration goes inside the Holy of Holies, which is always in darkness? And once a year, one priest goes in and sprinkles some blood on the cover. The rest of the time, it's in complete darkness. Who can see it? Only God. The outside of the tent's black. Just black. Goat's hair on the outside. All the fine decoration is all surrounding, so it's all saying that it's about honouring God. But it was just a standard nomadic tent. It was portable. You could take it down, fold it up, because God travels with us. You come to the new place, you put it back up again. God says, move on, you take it down, and it moves with you. And it was making the point, because in those days, the surrounding nations believed that the God was a God of territory. So this bit of ground here had this God, and you came into this ground, you better worship the God of this bit. And you leave that bit, and you go to this bit over here, and you better worship the God of that bit. But the Israelites knew that all of that was just not true. There was one God. And in fact, he was everywhere, but he traveled with his people. He was there in the centre of his people. And that is an awesome difference. And I've tried to convey that. It's very difficult for us because we're so familiar with God being with us, the Holy Spirit in our lives. But this was the first time that God came to be with his people, among his people. So let's, in the last few minutes, we've got just 2 or 3 minutes left. Coming out of these two chapters, these 77 verses that we've looked at this morning, what are the things that we take away that actually matter for our lives this week, this month? What do we take away from these chapters? What are the key things? Yeah, Leslie.
That things have to be done according to God's way. What he says, that's what we have to.
Yeah. There's no wriggle room.
There you go.
No wriggle room. God says, do it this way, you do it that way. No wriggle room with God. Dorothy.
God is with us wherever we go.
God is with us, journeying with us wherever we go. He's with us all the time. Mary.
But right from the beginning, God wanted a tabernacle with his people.
Yeah. It was always God's intention from the Garden of Eden all the way through to Revelation, his intention. Lorraine.
He's concerned about the finest details of our life, things that we think that are unimportant or important to him.
Yeah, he's concerned about the fine detail of our lives. Things that we think are unimportant really matter to him, yes.
Just the only reason that God can dwell with us is because the blood that was shed by Christ.
Yeah, very good. It's the only reason that God can dwell with us. The only reason he could dwell with the people then was because of the blood that was shed then. They thought it was just animal blood, but of course it pointed forward to Jesus' death. So the only reason that God can be among us is because the blood of Jesus shed on the cross. Thank you. Timmy.
He's concerned about the inside rather than the outside.
Very interesting. Yes, he's concerned about the inside rather than the outside. All the detail is about the inside, not the outward appearance. Right, final two.
God loves us and he looks on our hearts. And although he hates sin, he wants to be with us everywhere. And I'm getting a thing that's coming to me that says, Jesus, feel free to be among us in the spirit of our lives.
Okay, so God is among us in Jesus, everywhere. Absolutely. Mary.
That God had provided the gold and silver and the stones, everything they were going to need for the tabernacle, long before they ever knew why they were going to need it.
Yeah, that is a really important point. Thank you. God had provided, you see, when they were leaving Egypt, they took, God said, ask them for this stuff. They took it all with them. They didn't know what it was for. And that's, God is us like that. You know, we look back at our lives and we find the way that God has done things. God has provided things for us. And suddenly, years later, we think, that's what God was up to. He put it in our hand then, and it's for now. One of the things that Warren is finding in his new role here, working full-time for us as my assistant, is that things that God put in his hand in the past, he had no idea what this was about. Suddenly, it's now coming into focus. This is why God did that. This is why God did that. And that's true for all of us, because God does that. So when God says to you, pick that up and take it with you, it's a really smart idea to listen to God. Because otherwise, there'll come a point later on and you won't have what you need because you've been disobedient in the past. Because God takes care of the fine detail. Let's stand together. Let me pray for you as we finish this morning. Father God, I thank you that it has always been your heart and your intention to be among us, your people. Right back at the beginning, right the way through to now, it's been your heart and intention to be among us. Father God, thank you. Thank you. And thank you that you made it possible at your expense in sending Jesus into the world, his blood shed for us. Father, thank you. And I want to ask, Father, for us this week, we here, now your tabernacle, the living temple, the living stones among whom you dwell, that this week for us, at college, at work, at home, with our friends and neighbours, moving house, whatever situation, whatever context, whatever place we are, that we will know you with us, Emmanuel, God with us, God in our situation, God in our circumstances, and that we will allow you to reveal yourself through us to people around us. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Please sit down. If you've got children in creche or Sunday club, if you could go and collect them, because we've run just 3 minutes over. So if you'd like to go and do that quickly, that would be really helpful. Thank you.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.